Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Talk to Me, How to Ask Better Questions, Get Better Answers, and Interview Anyone Like a Pro by Dean Nelson. Read by Michael David Axtell. More Than Instinct. Asking better questions, getting better answers. Here's my best excuse. I was young and didn't know any better. When I was in my mid-20s, in my first journalism job in central Missouri, I saw a calendar listing that said a jazz musician was going to do a concert in my town. That was my beat, and I naively assumed he'd have some time to talk to me while he was here, so I called around trying to reach him. I ended up with a phone number for his record label and called it, blissfully unaware that I was calling California from the Midwest, and it was 7 a.m. there. A groggy voice answered, and I explained who I was and what I was trying to do. The voice mumbled that I could probably reach the musician at the hotel where he was staying. "And what hotel might that be?" I asked. He named the hotel in Boston. "And to whom was I speaking?" I asked. When he told me his name, I looked at the information I had about the record label. Yep, I had just called the head of the label out of a deep sleep. As I said, I was young and didn't know any better. So I called the hotel, and again, the phone rang a long time. Another voice answered. I guess I woke him up, too. It was 10 a.m. in Boston. What a sleepy bunch these music people were. I told him who I was and asked if I could spend some time with him when he was in my town in a few weeks. "Sure, I guess that would be okay," he said. "Is there any chance you could make that exclusive to me and you don't talk to any other reporters?" I knew I was pushing my luck with that one. "For that, you'll have to pay me," he said. He was clearly waking up. "I'm sure I can't do that, so I'll see you when you get into town." I ended up spending the entire day with him as he gave high school jazz band workshops and was backstage with him before and after his show that night. He wasn't the warmest person I've ever met, but it was fun to see this legend take the teenagers, and me, seriously. He walked slowly. His short, heavy-set body was relaxed as he moved from chair to music stand at the high school. We talked off and on for hours. I made some mistakes while interviewing him, and even angered him at one point. Note to self, don't ever ask a jazz musician about the irony of coming out of a life of poverty and oppression and charging an enormous fee for performing. You would think that even a guy in his 20s would know better than to ask Dizzy Gillespie about something as personal as money. But back then, I was under the illusion that getting the perfect interview was 90% getting the right person to interview and 10% luck or instinct. I figured that once I got him to agree, the rest would take care of itself. What I have learned over the last 40 years as a journalist, working with publications such as the New York Times, the Boston Globe, the San Jose Mercury News, and multiple magazines, and running the Writers' Symposium by the Sea in San Diego, is that there is much more to an interview than just getting the person to talk to you. More than 30 years later, when I was back in that town and took my old editor to lunch, he brought up this event. "I still can't believe you got that interview," he said. We have questions. We want answers. I've learned a lot about interviewing since the Dizzy Gillespie event. First and foremost, that interviewing is more common than most of us realize. We ask questions every day because we need to know something, or because we need information so our next decision will be an informed one, or we want to be able to share wisdom, or we want to avoid trouble, or maybe we're just nosy. Mostly, we're trying to gain perspective on something. If we depend solely on our own thoughts and observations and don't take into account the thoughts and observations of others who are not just like us, we run the risk of coming to inaccurate conclusions and possibly taking harmful actions. Other perspectives reveal our own biases and assumptions. And think of what could have been accomplished and avoided in our history had we just asked a few more questions. Asking good questions keeps us from living on our own echo chambers. Think of the questions we have heard or have asked. Questions as simple as, What is the secret to your chocolate chip cookies? What happened at school today? Did you think about the consequences? Would you like to have dinner with me? Will you marry me? Why is the coffee always gone? On the one hand, those are simply questions, but they can lead to other questions and become conversations that will draw out personalities and understandings. They can become a kind of interview. The questions that surround us may be simple and obvious, they may be cosmic and profound, but they all serve a function. Consider the following scenarios from everyday life, in this case, mine. There is a plate of spaghetti on the floor, and the dog is eating it as if he had been waiting his entire life for this moment. His tail is wagging hard enough to spin a turbine. I look at my young son. He is standing, frozen in place, hands outstretched, eyes as big as the plate that is upside down on the floor directly under his hands. I look at my daughter, who is 3 years younger than my son. She is at the kitchen table, silently crying, not because of the lost spaghetti or the stained carpet, but because she thinks I am going to punish the dog. What happened? I ask. That's an interview question. It's a dumb interview question, more on asking dumb questions later, because it's obvious what happened, but it's an interview question nonetheless. Maybe a better question would be, how did this happen? And then, what do you think is about to happen? But we'll talk about that more in chapter 6. I call the bank because I'm having trouble with my account. I always call customer service people with a certain dread because I assume they won't know anything. How can I make your day better? The voice asks. That's an interview question. I answer and she follows up with another question. She's trying to help me figure something out. The flashing lights in my rearview mirror could mean one of two things. One, the highway patrol is going to nail that guy who blew past me a few seconds ago. Cool. I love it when they get the guys in the BMWs. Or, two, the highway patrol is coming after me for blowing past the Buick a few seconds ago. It's me. I pull over to the shoulder and roll down my window. The officer swaggers up and leans toward me. Do you have any idea how fast you were going? That's an interview question, sort of. It's a bit rhetorical. He doesn't really need an answer before he writes me a ticket. The snow is marvelous, and today feels like a good day to try something new. I head down a trail I have never skied before, assuming it couldn't be that difficult on a day with such glorious powder conditions. I'm not a great skier. I'd call myself adequate. So when I see the trail sign with double black diamonds as I speed past, I get a little concerned. Too late. I'm suddenly on a super advanced slope. Now I am airborne. I wipe out in a spectacular manner, skis and poles flying in various directions. My shoulder and helmet take most of the impact. I stay in a prone position, taking mental note as to whether I can feel all four limbs, all 10 digits. This crash was performed beneath a breathless audience on the chairlift passing above. Several cheer. Someone from the lift leans forward and down a little. Are you okay? She asks. It's an interview question, for a very brief interview, to determine whether she needs to call the ski patrol. The therapist welcomes me to his office, points to a chair for me to be seated, and sits behind his desk. We look at each other in silence for a few moments. Why are you here? He gently asks. It's an interview question. It's how a lot of counseling sessions begin. I listen enthusiastically to a jazz band at a club, and during a break, I walk up to the pianist and ask, "Did I hear a little Thelonious Monk buried in that last song?" That's an interview question that endears me to the band. Everyone is an interviewer. Insurance adjusters, social workers, lawyers, nurses, teachers, investigators, therapists, podcast hosts, customer service representatives, bankers, and police officers spend a good part of each day asking questions. And that's what an interview is, a purposeful series of questions that lead to understanding, insight, and perspective on a given topic. What these people do next depends on the quality of the answers they get, and the quality of those answers has a lot to do with the quality of the questions. I once had a doctor who never looked up from his computer screen when he asked me questions. I had visits in his exam room for a torn rotator cuff, skin cancer, migraines, and annual physicals. I could barely describe him to you, because all I ever really saw was his hairline over the screen. He asked questions and pounded on those keys like he was trying to smash a scorpion under the keyboard. In that same clinic, I had a doctor who asked me questions other than just what my symptoms were and how often I was going to the bathroom. We talked about our joint love for the lakes in Minnesota and our joint lament over the quality of journalism in the country. The second doctor's visits didn't take much longer than the first, but guess which doctor I was willing to be more open with? Guess who was better able to help me figure out some of my physical issues? Doctors are under lots of pressure from insurance companies to spend as little time with patients as possible and to document everything. I get it. But even medical journals write that the interviewing skills of doctors can be key to developing adequate diagnoses and therapies for their patients. Good doctors do more than order lots of tests. They ask questions. They listen. They evaluate. They follow up. They interview. Once I recognized the intentional line of questioning, I appreciated what the second doctor was doing. He wasn't just getting to know me in a casual sense. It wasn't like we were going to go out for drinks later. He was gathering information so he could develop a plan. He was, in an informal way, taking my medical history, which is a term doctors use for conducting an interview. It was a conversation, but directed toward a specific goal. Other careers depend on quality interviews, too. A social worker I know told me that how she works with a client depends on what the client tells her, and what the client tells her is a direct result of the questions she asks. The interview is everything. Same story for human resources, where the interview is the time you can look past that mountain of near-identical resumes and find out what really sets a candidate apart. Law? A deposition is an interview. Jury selection is a series of interviews. So is a trial, when lawyers ask witnesses questions. Financial planners? I have never been asked more personal questions than when I talked to a financial planner. He was interested in my family's goals, our definitions of success and comfort and security. Those were all interview questions. Journalists, of course, ask a lot of questions. It's their job. Most of their careers depend on their ability to conduct a good interview. As a journalist, I have interviewed people who were overjoyed and those who were overwhelmed. Successful and gutted. Winners and losers. Interesting and dull. Saintly and corrupt. Heroes and antichrists. Virtually every profession depends on getting people to talk to you. And the good news is that conducting a great interview is something you can learn. We see doctors, lawyers, police officers, and journalists on television or in movies, and it seems that they have a poised, professional, confident manner when they conduct interviews. They look like naturals. The shows give the impression that conducting a great interview depends entirely on your being an extrovert with insatiable curiosity. We get a stereotype in our minds about interviewing, that we're just born with the interviewing gene or we're not. But I don't think that's the case at all. Remember, everyone is an interviewer. Every profession has its times where we need to ask questions of strangers. Boisterous and confident people can be great interviewers. Marc Maron is very good at this. He gives off an air that says, "It's so cool that you're talking to me on my podcast. But of course, you wanted to talk to me in the first place." For Maron, it's a combination of little kid wonder and arrogance, and it works for him. But shy and insecure people can be great interviewers too. Some of the best interviewers I have seen are tentative, non-combative, soft-spoken people. Their personalities put people at ease and make them easy to talk to. They know their subject well, and they know that their source can help them gain even more understanding, and they are okay with being vulnerable. I heard the journalist Catherine Boo describe how she got people in Mumbai to be so open with her in her book, Behind the Beautiful Forevers. She said that she showed up so often that people sort of forgot that she was there.
Good interview. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.